Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sun Sphere Tactical Attack Brigade Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Will. New models don't make you play better, Heim. With Ryan TOing against the Wasky. Ben, Sci-Fi City is for chumps, Fowler. And Tim, definitely Mr. Positive Hannon, has positively declined to appear on this episode.
He's positive for COVID, maybe, but... No. Welcome, everybody. Wow.
Positively something, isn't he?
Positively
an asshole.
It's not me for once. This is weird.
This is true. Just give me the grief, Tim. Give me the grief.
He's already turned it off.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, he never even turned it on. I just be honest. So don't worry. I tend to use the work excuse pretty often, but definitely Tim tried to play it off tonight. I don't think he had work. I didn't feel it in the text message.
Gonna have to go see who's on Scoundrels this week.
That is the pot calling the kettle black. I don't stand up for Tim very often, but
I mean, I had to do a work excuse last night. So
yeah, right. Yeah,
you did. Like I said, but mine are often—they're always work excuses. Like they really are work excuses. Tim's,
So you're like the sommelier of work excuses. You're like Tim's is That's cheap box trash.
This is box trash. Some blend, you know.
Versus served my expertly aged student punched another student in the forehead. Excuse, you know.
Yes. This week on the 149th episode of the STABcast, Will went to a tournament. I TO'd a tournament. Ben made work excuses.
I had grand plans to attend this tournament.
He played a Mindscape tournament, I think.
I played a Mindscape tournament. No, I actually had the list together. I did. I pulled some pieces together. All my models were there. And then something did come up. I was not able to go on Saturday. In fact, it's so much so that I had not offloaded. Don't get me wrong. Ryan felt it in the wind. He could feel things
of
me not
doing. I did. I pestered him all week about
four times.
When can I come get tables? I know you're not going to show up at the store.
And so what we did is we did a table exchange. Ryan already had four tables, I think, at his house. I brought him four more. Put them in his Civic. It fit nicely. I was very impressed by it.
Play a little Jenga.
It doesn't have the luxuriousness of the Passat.
You're not cramming it in the tiny blue car anymore.
Yeah. But yeah,
I mean, the new one's not that much bigger, but yeah.
Right.
So I want to talk about my list only because the droid players love me to talk about my list, but also I'll take the public feedback because I did not get to play it.
And yeah, honestly, and we're going to need it because are you going to get a game before
probably not.
Before Orlando?
Yeah, I mean, you guys have, what, 2 weeks?
Looking at my schedule, probably not going to happen before I fly out, not this Thursday, but next Thursday.
Oh, you have 10 days. So, okay, yeah.
Yeah, I have 10 days.
He's not maybe. Unless I TTS him another night this week.
That's true. We might happen. Labor Day. We could do it. We could play Labor Day.
There you go.
Yeah. Possibly. But yeah. So the last list I described to you, I played against Ryan. I liked it. I did. There's some things I thought didn't work. Some things that did work. I love the idea of the way the special forces now can almost triple in size because you can bring strike teams. They get that bonus there.
Right.
It's just bonus activations. So you get past that number there.
But you don't get to pad with just strike teams anymore, which I think is fair.
Yes, yeah. Which I also think is fair. You've got to invest in the full squad. And I actually have always liked my BXs. I just struggle to give them the orders to get to that pierce. It being lethal and not having tactical, because for some reason, ARCs have both those things.
Well, you're far more tactical than you, silly droid.
Yes. Listen, I saw that cartoon. That little droid danced all over that tent before finally dying.
I would call that agile more than tactical.
Yes. Give me agile. I'll take agile. All day, every day.
No, I won't. I'll give you AI
So here's, so here's what I ended up going with. I went with Pogel the Lesser with strict orders. I did not add improvise on him this time. I took that away. That's because I have Kraken with improvised orders, aggressive tactics, and environmental gear.
Sure.
I've got B1 Battle Droids with the E5S, two B1 Battle Droids with E5S, and the PK Series Worker Droids. That's right. I added the worker droids to my list. Mm-hmm. I'm going to break all their arms before I get to Florida.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's the medbot with the silly arms.
Yes, it's a very... Oh, that's right, you're right. It's the other silly. Yeah, he's the one with the little robot baby.
He's cradling the little robot baby.
He's just a wee lad, yeah.
A baby
that tells you how often I've taken these things. I've forgotten which one they are, but you're right. I did bring the... the beef 2, I'm going to call it beef 2 because I don't like the other term. I don't like double stuffed. I like the beef 2, I do.
Kendra calls them beef twos.
I do like it. The ACM B2s with the extra battle squad in it. It's 165 points, but my God, the dice you are throwing.
Yeah, it's absurd. Yeah,
it's just absolutely so many dice. I am bringing the BX Series Droid Commandos with the Doxus Mind Saboteur and Vibro Swords. So that seems like lots of fun. And I brought another set. The other two sets have impact grenades on them. I was just short of the points because I am 1,000 points even. And then two BX strike teams with the sniper and deflector shields. Since they're such small groups, and I'm depending on them to be snipers, I decided to go with the deflector shields.
Yeah.
I might pull those off between now and then and put those. I mean, that's a lot of points. That's another B1 squad. So
yeah, awfully close. No, I don't hate the deflector shields. You know.
No, I don't. I like it.
Will, you were talking about how you don't mind the fact that strike teams, like, you can't pad with them now because you have to take their big, expensive friends.
Right.
I'll be real honest. I've not played a ton of strike teams. I've not played against a ton of strike teams. With the new cover rules, like, they're gamble to take. I don't know that they're like the auto includes that they were before.
Oh,
with
my,
the way low profile changed.
I played an arc strike team, which don't get low profile, and they still died like every game once they got a little too forwards, or like I had to throw them in to score a point, and then my opponent would be like, neat, bang, and they'd just die.
Sure.
So I can't, the white save one, I'm sure they just melt if they're caught out.
And the snipers got so expensive, and probably rightfully so. The small dice pools, you know, with Pierce or some sort of access to Pierce, and then you know, usually some kind of sharpshooter does some gnarly stuff.
Yeah, so. I will say that even though it died every game, it also hit really well before dying in most games. Like,
so
it's able to pick off at least two models usually with it most times.
I think the Civil War snipers are maybe a touch too expensive, and maybe the others as well. I think time will tell if they... But where's the point? I think there's a very fine line between where they're, like, nowhere to be seen and then just being spammed everywhere.
I agree.
So...
If I can find the points, I'm not real sure where I'll get them back from. I may go ahead and equip emergency transponders. I do love that on a strike team for that one time I really need this to happen.
Sure.
It's only 4 points, so I've just got to find the points to get to it.
I think you'll have a lot easier time with getting your lethal to trigger on your snipers now that I should
override.
Before I say
that's
this.
True. You're right.
No, it's not, I'm not even thinking about override. I'm thinking about the super attacks are the former Republic keyword that I can't think of exemplars, right?
Yes, they are now. Yes.
Yeah. So you can get aims, like stack aims up on Kraken and, you know, have him strategize maybe himself, which is probably the option now instead of strategizing to somebody else, just because then anybody at range two can then use that.
Yeah. It's more flexible with exemplar unless you know that one unit will spend both, like, pretty well. I guess they're different tokens, so you wouldn't spend them both in the same, because exemplar is still one token.
And I know you're gonna hate this, Ben, but I would probably cut Poggle's strict to go up to to go up to Kalani for that extra strategize,
but Kraken for the memes. I see what Ben's doing. He's got gear for charge.
I mean, if you want to run your expensive commander
nothing
at me,
nothing will stand
like,
in the way of him punching four red dice once and then dying.
I think when I originally did this list, I was at 998, and I was like, I got 2 points, environmental gear, slap that bad boy on there.
I think
it's your fourth melee unit. You have all these BXs with swords and Kraken with his punching hands.
I mean, but remember what new Kraken is, though. It is four red dice in melee. It is three dice range, one to three. Lethal one, he does.
Yeah.
Well, but not? Also surge crit. I mean,
and then his gun is three red, right?
Yeah, gun is three red now. So
yeah, he's good at doing damage now that the cover doesn't just eat his entire die pool for.
I don't know. Exemplar Kalani was strategized because you can strategize yourself, right? I'm assuming
you can.
I think it's like
it's like all the other handouts. Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
I think I'm moving improvised orders to Poggle just to balance out the points, so in case he dies at about the same amount of point cost. But
does he have double command?
He does.
Yeah.
Neat.
Kalani gets three.
Yeah, Kalani's. Why not? He's the, yeah. he's the special lad.
he's just, well, he doesn't he's, get override, but he does get direct.
Override. Who cares? Who cares? Override is a worthless keyword now.
Oh, it lets you do all the AI stuff I was already doing by perfect order control. Now I don't have to worry about that.
It's yeah, that, it extends you to range five.
It should be surprised how often that came up. We had to, I do AI against you, Ryan. So
yeah, and it didn't matter.
Anyhow, dear listeners, like I said, if you've got an opinion about the thing, yeah, we'll playing with it. Yeah,
we'll post a link to this list in the show notes. Ben will be open to all feedback, as you guys are going to have to help him do well at Crucible. And if you fail him, we'll blame you and not him.
Exactly. Mental legions are mental.
We'll be sure to read all that feedback after Crucible and then say, oh, yeah, absolutely. I probably should have done
on
that.
The plane flight down. Yeah. Well.
I'm going to have to see if I can borrow some minis. Well, we can escape the theater of the mind, and I played real Legion.
Yeah, you did.
Oh, look at you, buddy.
In Aurora, Colorado, at Tacticon.
Nice.
But I do have a bone to pick with Joe. I brought a table of terrain all the way up there, and I arrived late, so they didn't need mine. They'd already set up every table.
Well, cool. Is that a bone to pick with Joe if you, like, you...
Yes.
We're the journalists. We get to write the narrative. You could have just left that bit out and been like, I brought terrain. They didn't want mine. You didn't have to admit to being late. Like, we make the narrative, Will.
Yes, but unlike other shows, we don't abuse our positions. Well, yeah, Tim
you're
does.
Right.
But...
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, I mean, yes, yeah. Tim uses that position to theoretically get him to open doors, which is surprising because normally our name shuts doors.
Yeah, I don't know why our name would bring prestige, but...
No, that is not true. Will, you remember the first time someone recognized you from the podcast? There's a joy to that. I remember the first time I was recognized. Yes. Good Screw Tape, Charlotte, North Carolina, RPQ. Mm. Many, many, many years ago. We were younger men then. You and I.
Much younger men.
I remember when you and I were walking around Adepticon and someone stopped us and was like, I know you're Will and Ben, but I don't know which is which.
I don't know who's who.
There is that. And of course, Tim likes being the Legion socialite who has appeared in many places.
Yes, indeed.
He's like those game show hosts from the 70s. You don't really know who they are. You don't know that you've ever seen a movie with them in it, but they're all over those shows, so you feel like you know them.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Tim would definitely appear on Legion Celebrity Squares.
Yeah. But never the center square. He could never hold the center square.
No. We'll need to get Tim the I'm sure he can do the coat himself, but the long stem pen microphone.
Yes.
To carry around with a cord that's attached to nothing, yeah.
Well, enough about our journalistic integrity
and lack thereof.
Yeah. I went up to Denver. I played 501st Legion, which I successfully painted in 21 days.
That's not Wookiees, sir.
It is not Wookiees. It's better than melee Wookiees because they get red saves and throw better die pools.
Yeah, you're right, though.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
Yeah, so it was Anakin Rex. Anakin had all the goodies, push and burst, and then tenacity and seize. So I could seize on Call Me Captain.
Okay.
Rex had his jetpack and some recon intel, and Esteemed Leader that I used a total of once in the entire tournament, and I blocked one hit with it. So well done. That should have been improvised for all the times I pulled the wrong token and wanted to improv it.
Yeah, I think improv is so important in 2-6.
Especially since I have a single support in the list that gets pulled at inconvenient times a lot. So it's Anakin Rex, triple arcs with the Reliable One commander. Yep. I believe that's the commander, not the captain. He gives Reliable One and Inspire One. I never used Inspire, but you I did use to. Reliable just to stuff myself full of surge tokens.
Yep.
I had two double stuffed clone infantries with Z6s.
Okay, just playing the lottery. I like it.
Yeah. No, I mean, once you're throwing 15 dice, the white dice show up. Like,
throw enough of them.
Yeah. You throw enough stuff, like, when they would shoot with their free surge and then usually an aim, they would get, like, 7-8 hits, usually.
Jeez.
Just good offense to have.
Yeah, that sounds about right. I mean, yeah.
So, and they were really good at just being giant health pools for people to shoot into and be like, oh no, two clones. Ah. Like, I'm still holding this point. You know, they,
yeah.
There's they only six more left to go.
I had a single arc sniper team, and then 501st requires at least one support, so I was forced to take one commando team.
Oh no, you poor child.
Yes. Which doesn't feel as oppressive when there's only one of them, but they're still bonkers how cheap
they're
they are for what they do.
They're still 75 good. Points, yeah.
They're
yeah,
so like, good.
They're still real good.
Can I have 75 point tauntauns? I want 75 point tauntauns.
Do you want 75 point tauntauns that shoot 4 red at range 4?
Yeah, that'll be great.
Well, too bad. melee arcs are nuts, by the way, because you move twice with tactical and have charge, so you have two mm-hmm. free aims on 10 black dice into a charge.
Yes. Yeah, yes.
Just
yeah.
Some people were surprised by that, so I just wanted to let that put that out first, that Anakin and arcs are very good at doing damage to people.
Almost every Republic player I've played so far has had not everyone, but almost all of them have had fives in a clone infantry squad with the shotgun just for that.
Yeah.
And the full squad behind it. So it's like a billion dice.
Yeah. But the difference is the scout move, I think.
No, absolutely, for sure.
My entire list scouts too effectively because of Rex, because mm-hmm. all the arcs do it, Rex does it, and then he gives scouting party the two infantry squads. Anakin has prepared position, and the commandos yep. infiltrate. So yep. none of my units have to waste an action moving onto the board.
That's so gnarly.
It, like, I get to pick where the engagements happen effectively. Mm-hmm. Like, and they're usually much further, like, closer to my opponent, so I pin them in a lot of the time. Speaking of which, round one. I played John.
Hot transition. Well done.
Yes. I played John's Bright Tree. He stuffed it full of all the characters. He had Han, Leia, Wicket, Logray, 3PO, and AT-ST Chewie.
Yeah, that's how you do it.
And then I think like 4 skirmishers and 3 slingers. Like it was 14 acts, I think.
Sounds about right.
He didn't have any trappers. He had a couple axes and a couple of the charge cards.
Oh, no trappers. So no. I mean, I guess you don't need log trap when you've got that many other command cards.
Right. He's like, well, I didn't want to pay the points or have to sacrifice a command card.
Yeah.
So we ended up on close the pocket, sweep and clear. And then we both had a cunning deployment. So we got some free dodges.
Did you just sing a Mary Poppins tune to us?
Yeah, he sure did.
I sure did.
Close the pocket, sweep and clear. Close the pocket, sweep and clear.
Bye. Where's my penguins?
No! Get that evil out of here.
That's right, listeners. In case you've forgotten, Ryan has an irrational fear of penguins.
It's not a fear. It's a blood feud.
And it's rational. He was bitten.
It is rational.
The big difference in this game is that I got to pin him basically into his deployment zone. And then the difference in staying power, I think, was the real big difference. Like, red saves with surges blocked most of the damage his units could do to me. Like, Han picked up a few clones with his pew-pews like he does, but I was able to spend a few dodges to get out of them, which always feels good.
Mm-hmm.
But then Han was donkey punched by ARC troopers, so you know, he runs forward and shoots twice and then dies like normal, and then Chewie did some decent damage from the back, but from the back, Ben.
From the back.
Phrasing? This isn't your entire battle port. There's phrasing everywhere.
Yeah, I know.
Between donkey punching and
damage from behind.
From the back.
He put Anakin onto one wound, and then Anakin died to some Ewok slingers, so the gravel was very effective. But that was after Anakin played his one pip and killed Logray and 3PO and 4 Ripple Troopers. So
gross.
Oh, and killed Wicket the turn before. So he was just on a on a commander hunting spree, I suppose. Is Wicket
so? Is it true to storyline? He does hate small people and children.
Yes, he's very good at killing small people and children. Yes. I was able to score the full 4 on close the pocket, on turn two, and I basically just rode those points out the rest of the game to carry me. Like, I had the... We only played on a third of the board, and then my commandos were just standing on the far point like, hey guys, we're just scoring 5 points, no biggie. And
yeah, that's a tough draw for Brighttree, because you know, normally Brighttree wants to be the one to get in to melee where your dice are better and your opponents are worse, and you can kind of make the... Like, the defensive trade-off isn't as bad.
Right.
But you're just better there.
Yeah, like, he had one melee squad that was, like, double-stuffed with the charge card, and they got into an arc squad and killed, like, four of them on the charge, but that was basically the only good offense he got for most of the game.
Right, yeah.
You know, like, he threatened me with Brains and Brawn with ATSD Chewy, but then he didn't have it in his hand, so...
Oh, no!
He had all three Wicket cards, and then Wicket died turn two.
Yeah, Wicket's so hard to keep alive.
Especially when he charges into Anakin on turn one and does a single point of damage. It's like, thank you for my tenacity. Oh, and I'm going to kill you using Tempted now. Bang!
Yeah.
It was gross. Yeah.
And I mean, I'm assuming just because it's Anakin, you were in enemy territory when you did so. There's some kills in the contested territories.
I got 4 points out of sweep. I did not get the friendly territory one because I didn't stand in friendly territory long enough to kill things from there. Like, I was out of my territory at the end of one kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the only thing you have that can score back there is probably your commandos and just try to get up, pick off with their snipers, and then score a point. But it's better just to go sit on the... If he left a point abandoned.
Basically, like, he put one slinger over there, and then I put my commandos down, and they just instantly, like, sniped off four of them and then shot them again to kill them. And he's like, I'm just not going to deploy anything else there. You win. I'm like, okay. But it was a pretty convincing win, 13-3.
Woof. For me on that one. Well done.
Then we had lunch break and a painting competition, which I did not win, but I was commended for my completed army being painted fully, which was good enough for me, I guess.
Okay.
No, I think they turned out really well for being in a rush. I put pictures on our Instagram.
They do look nice. They do.
They do.
My phone blew up this weekend with all the likes of the thing. So
yes. Ryan made a post, and then I posted for each round I played, so... Got a lot of cool photos. After the break, game two versus Sam. He was playing Grievous, three Sniper B1s with repair droids, then two B2s with the three red, and then four Magnas with whips.
Ooh,
I like it.
Yeah. It was a ton of close range melee damage and healer bots.
Yeah.
And we ended up on breakthrough sweep and clear, and we both had fortified as our advantage, so we plopped some barricades down that didn't really matter, but
I think immobilize stuff that everything lanes, is like proximity objectives is so much better.
I like it a lot. Yeah.
Yeah, no, they were terrifying.
And I want to say it's considerably cheaper than the rocket guy. I think it's not just like
it is dramatically cheaper. Yes.
Yeah. And you still get the two wound body out of it. You know.
Yeah.
So I did not know how to approach this because normally I'm the one with all the close range firepower that people are afraid of. Mm-hmm. But I was looking at all of his equipment and I was impressed, staggered by the amount of it. Yes. And because of how breakthrough is, we kind of had two different fronts running, where one side was like Rex, all my arcs, and one of my Z6 squads, and the other side is where I had pre-deployed Anakin with prepared positions, and then he completely avoided Anakin,
as he should. But then
he dropped one of his Magnas down there just to slow me down, which actually mattered a lot.
I like this plan. I like the plan.
So we start kind of skirmishing, and my red saves are nowhere to be found. He shoots at one of my arc squads with a B1 and gets three hits, and I triple blank it on turn one. I'm just like, okay, we're done. Neat. Nothing's working. Cool. So The first scoring opportunity goes very well for me. I hold both of mine, and I score the far objective with Anakin.
Okay.
So I got 4 points. And I had gotten some more kill points out of him. So I had this 5-point lead, and I just had to hold on to it. Because I was definitely losing the battle on the table.
Sure.
I just had to try to slow him down long enough that my points lead would hold out. Like he was trying to claw back up to me. And on turn 3, Anakin fought the Magnas over on that side and killed them all but a unit leader. And that single unit leader stopped me scoring his breakthrough point that turn.
Yep.
And that was basically the window he needed to claw back into it. At the end of 4, I was ahead 11-10. So if I'd gotten that breakthrough point, the game would have been over because I would have scored 12 and won the game.
Sure.
But instead, we played turn 5, and I had about 4 units on the table. So he was able to score all the points and flip it to a 16-14 win for him.
I mean, that's kind of how our game of Breakthrough we played a couple weeks ago went, Ben. Like,
yeah,
similar way, yeah.
Yeah. Breakthrough is one of the most interesting ones, I think, because of how you have to balance the table.
It's probably one of my favorites so far.
Yeah.
It and Bunker Assault.
Yeah, but by the end, we're both just, like, super sweaty. Like, I had one chance to get, like, a miracle shot out of a Z6 and kill 6 health worth of Magnas that would have gotten me... We realized it wouldn't have won the game, but at the time it was like, oh, man, if I get this, it might matter, you know. But
sure.
Did not roll the miracle dice on the slot machine of Z6s. So,
I mean,
super close game, great opponent. Had a great time, even though I lost. Like, it's one of those where you can't be mad. Like,
No.
We both both played our hearts out.
They can't be.
Right.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
And I think I had a play with Force Push on that turn 3 that I didn't see, which would have got me those points and won me the game. So it was something, like, in my control that cost me the game. So that feels a little better than, like, my dice were bad. You know, like, no, I can see where I could have still pulled it out. So super good game, great opponent. But puts me to 1-1, which is always the scary part for a 3-round event. Because, I want to go 2-1 at least is kind of a good showing, right? So puts the pressure on round 3.
But, the old reverse Tim Hannon.
Listen, we don't need to talk about that.
It was a long time ago.
No, I'm just talking about, I think most of Tim's results are the good old, 1-2 with a bye.
Oh, yes. I see. I thought you were talking about that time at Dicehead 4 years ago where he and I were competing for the invite and then he won it and didn't go to Worlds that year.
Right.
Sorry, I had actually forgotten all about that. I knew that he'd won the invite, and he'd beaten you for it. I'd forgotten that he then didn't attend.
He might have attended, but I mean, did he really?
That's even worse, I think.
Wow.
No, he did attend because it was the after pandemic boogaloo where there were like 300 people.
Oh. That's right.
Because it was one of the hockey puck invites, the little circle coaster.
Mm.
Anyway, enough about Dicehead 4 years ago.
If you're talking about emulating your opponents, and perhaps that gives you the win there, did you try taking off your shirt and vomiting in the middle of this game?
You went further back.
I went further back. Ryan, Will once had an opponent who, in the middle of their very first game, literally pulled his shirt off, like, oh, I'm not feeling well, goes to the bathroom, vomits everywhere, comes back in, beats up on Will.
Yes.
Yep. That was the thing that happened.
It's like,
we all watched it.
It was intimidating.
It was. I mean, so much pale flesh there. I don't understand why. this opponent exposed himself to Will.
I didn't know where his nipples were.
It's like...
And then you did.
It's like those birds you throw up on you. You're like, and you just run away. That was game 2, though. Game 2. That was not what Sam did to Will. But Will should have been to Sam in order to win. Play the psychological games. Play the player, not the game, Will.
That's right.
Indeed. Tell you.
I should have been more intimidating and not taking shots from Joe during the round. Because it's why
Joe's the hero we need, not the one we deserve.
At the start of round 2, the con organizers like came around and was like, "Who wants a beer?" And everybody who raised the hand, they got a free beer for the round.
Nice.
All right, that's nice.
And then, like, halfway through the round, Joe comes around. He's like, hey, you want some tequila? And I'm like, I'm not going to say no. So he comes around with, like, tequila shots, and I do two of them. I'm feeling amazing, but it might have made me
I've got 4 hours before this game is over.
Right. I got to drive home in 7 hours, so fine. That's fine.
We're fine. We're all fine. Exactly.
Yeah. But that may have contributed to me missing a technical play with force push on turn three.
Oh.
But still my fault, so. Game three versus Aaron. Made us play a Republic Mirror, and Republic Mirrors are weird now.
Yeah.
It's a lot of red saves bouncing off of each other, except for
yeah.
how Anakin is real good at killing red saves.
Yes, don't you know? Yes, he is. Yeah. I kind of feel like it's probably the exact opposite of the Rebel Mirror, where
you guys just mouth at each other.
Yeah, it's like it is about who gets the first big like upswing dice spike, because we've got the bad defense dice with the typically like good offensive dice.
Sure.
This is probably like who bombs the first defensive roll. Like
you're
it's
exactly
a momentum shift against
it's
them.
Like who rolls four blanks first? Yeah. It was he was playing Rex Cody Saber Tank.
Okay.
Double commando, single arc, and then some not double stuffed infantry squads with some melee, like a couple shotguns and a couple mm-hmm. rockets, I think. So he had one activation more than me, but I mean Rex Cody Saber Tank, it was intimidating.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And we played Close the Pocket with Destroy Enemy Base.
Close the Pocket's probably a bit of a push, but like Destroy the Enemy Base for you is probably like super great.
Yeah. Burst of Speed Anakin.
Especially
because
they're Rex
it.
Cody, because they're not going to want to get up in
yeah, this is a list that doesn't really want to, like, it wants to, to punish from a distance.
He put his bomb on his ARC squad, and then I put my bomb on Anakin, and both those units basically just deployed opposite from the... Because the deployment on Close the Pocket is just battle mm-hmm. lines, but the center is blanked out. You can't use it.
Right.
Right.
So the bunkers were in the corners, or enemy bases were in the corners, and then those squads just deployed opposite mm-hmm. and ran towards them. So both bases were destroyed at the end of two.
Oh, wow. Jeez. Ooh. Wow.
Yeah, this game was going fast. He took some pot shots out me on the approach, but then I was able to donkey punch Cody with an ARC squad, which he survived the first punch, but then on top of three, I ordered them and activated them first to punch him to death, which cost him all three Cody cards. So I had him on a card advantage there, too.
Yeah.
But the damage was coming in from his squads. His commandos killed mine pretty... I think it was... killed most of them on one and finished them off on turn two.
Yeah, I could see
and
that.
And then I was starting to lose momentum. Like, round two, I got a big score because that's what this list kind of does. Like, I was up mm-hmm. by 4 points, even with both... Like, at the end of two, I was ahead... 8-4.
All right, let me ask this. As playing Anakin, every game I've played against Anakin, I want to say, Anakin's one pip gets played turn two. Is that the reason you take a big upswing in points? Is because that's the Super Saiyan Anakin turn?
In my first game, yes. This game, no. I held his one pip for turn three because it was after the bomb, and I was able to close...
Back
around to the center where the main fight was, because he didn't deploy a ton against Anakin because he knew it would just die. So he kind of just left his base out to dry, but it meant Anakin had to go do it and then come back. But I didn't have to use burst until then either. So round three, burst of speed, triple move towards the center, kill a one health clone unit, and then charge another unit on the way. It's the ideal turn for him, picking up clones.
For sure.
And that swings the middle point back into my favor, and I hold the points advantage over him as we coast out. I was going to win it on four, but then he tied the middle, so I did not score enough points to end the game. But that just meant we coasted to a 11-8 win at the end of round five. It was a super fun game. Super weird with how the red saves interact. Like, I would have these, 10 dice arc punches where I'd be like, I got 7 hits. And then, oh, wait, red saves with a surge. That's like 2 damage.
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
I don't like this anymore. I want to go back to punching Ewoks.
I mean, and it sounds like that was the difference maker, was you had the melee pierce and he didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, and that just squeaked you enough ahead of the, you know, all things being, if all things were equal variance wise.
Right.
Just being able to ignore those extra 3 blocks around.
Yes.
So another reason for Tim to hate Pierce.
I don't hear him complaining about Anakin, though.
He does not. Nope.
Weird. Yeah, I think that's a good way of looking at it. And then we both had pretty consistent offensive dice, but then I was able to pull some, like, I had better momentum, I felt like. So, like, we played Call Me Captain on the same round, but I won the roll-off, so I started dealing damage to his Rex before he could kill my Rex, so that my Rex stayed alive and got to add more red dice into things. So it was, timing was also on my side, it felt like. Especially when Anakin came around and melee pierced his way through half of his back line.
Well, we know the Lord's on your side, so yeah.
Someone's got to be. It was definitely my favorite game of the weekend. And I had played Ben, Aaron's son, at the Rocky Mountain Open, so now I've gotten to play both of them.
Oh, nice.
They're cool. Good people.
So how'd you shake out? This was a 2-dayer there, right?
Technically, yes. It was one of those where it's like, you can come back tomorrow, or you don't have to, or you can play in this other event, or this other event. So,
sure.
Day 2 was kind of, it wasn't officially a top 8 cut, but almost everyone dropped for day 2.
Sure, for all intents and purposes, it was a top 8
cut.
Yeah.
So we had a few players continue in the original Swiss, like Huntsman Tony. He ended up 3-2 with his Republic, but a lot of people played 3 and then either dropped and played the randomizer lists, or there was a Shatterpoint event Sunday. You know, there was lots of stuff going on. I did not return because I just couldn't do the drive 2 days in a row. And
no, that makes sense. It's a long drive for you.
Yeah, it was an hour and a half, I needed one day of my weekend where I could relax, because the work week before had been rough with kids coming back. So I needed at least one day of, like, not being extroverted. But I still had a great time. Joe did all the prizes Saturday night because he knew, like, some people wouldn't come back or some people would be doing other things. So we did a great big raffle. I handed out some Stabcast POI tokens, which people...
Nice.
Some people took, and some people went, ew, which I understand.
Ew, gross.
Yeah.
Either way, I applaud you.
a Producer Daisy fanny pack was given out.
Nice.
The purple edition. It was very nice.
Ooh, the purple edition. I do like the color schemes on it. I do. It just came out
nice. They turned out really nice. But the event overall, my round one opponent played that round one game and then dropped, so my SOS is terrible. It is 1.
Woof.
So, I went 2-1, but I am 22nd, the lowest placing 2-1 player.
Yeah. Yeah.
If that did not happen, I'm probably closer to like 15, 16, somewhere like that.
Sure.
Because my kill points and my victory points are both pretty good scores, so those tiebreakers, I would get some decent breakage out of that. But yeah, my SOS was tanked by my round one opponent, who said, by the way, I'm dropping after this, sorry about your SOS. I was like, oh well, I guess I just have to win all 3 of my games. And then we laughed. Yep, and
just,
I didn't
just win.
And then we did not.
Nope.
So I've got to ask the question, is SOS the way tournaments are headed towards at the moment? I mean,
That's the way they're run right now, I believe.
I mean, that's the way the Galactic Conquest document says to do it.
Yes.
I have opinions too. And I don't have enough data to go back and look at.
I think
this never stopped us before.
Yeah, you're right.
There's a better argument for MOV now that points are more standardized to, like, the game ends at 12, you're scoring decent, like, you don't have an objective that wins 3-1 versus like 18-16
I could see, maybe not, and I don't even think you necessarily have to do MOV. I think, you know, we made fun of the game for being total victory points was like the 4th tiebreaker, and it made no sense with the old cards. obviously, if this was in their back pocket when they made that decision, this makes a lot more sense.
Yeah.
And I could honestly see that potentially becoming your first tiebreaker. Just scoring more points overall.
Yeah.
Does that influence the battle deck? I mean, everything scores at, you know, turns 2, 3, 4, 5.
I mean, I think you just...
Some are easier to score, so maybe... Yeah.
I think you go for secondaries that your list is more, like, reliable at getting, but you should be doing that anyway, so...
And then, I don't know, it's probably problematic because, and we talked a little bit about this before the show, I really don't like Recover the Research, but that probably becomes the best objective.
Yeah, because it's the most reliable scoring one.
Your opponent can't stop you from scoring it. Even if you're losing the game, you're still scoring points.
Right.
So, I don't know, maybe SOS, I need to...
We need to see more events and see how it plays out.
Exactly. I don't think I have enough of an opinion yet.
But for Tacticon, we had 45 total.
Nice. That's great.
And
great
Gus ended up taking the whole thing with his weird Empire Salad list. It was Kallus, Seventh Sister, Op Vader with a bunch of Stormtroopers and IRGs. So
yeah, I mean, classic. It's real skirmishy. It's,
yeah.
It's real, you know.
A ton of DLT like storms and... He had his contingency cards and all the things.
Mm-hmm.
Second place, our other 5-0 was a rebel player who...
Yeah.
His name is not his Longshanks name, so I don't know his real name. Sorry. But his rebel heroes was a Jin, Han, Sabine, Chewie list. So
okay,
lists are all over the place right now, which I...
Yeah, it's the Wild West.
Which I kind of love. Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
This list has Clan Ren and 2 Rotary Arties.
That's amazing.
Yeah, like
I'm still afraid to take the RTs, and maybe I just need to like not be. I just feel like they're liabilities.
One of our 2 Shadow Collective players went 4-1 with a Mando Gar Saxon list.
Heck yeah!
Listen, bravo on that.
Yeah,
I mean, because we've talked about. In fact, what was our original notes for one of these sessions? Was like, hey, and also they exist.
Yeah,
I think Shadow Collective is still perfect. I don't think they're oppressive like they were before.
No,
I still think they're really good. I think the Pike is dead.
Yeah, I played Pikes the other day, and they don't feel nearly as tanky as they used to because you don't get all that free canceling.
Yeah,
which is really fine by me because they shouldn't have.
But I think
still gross.
I think Black Suns are still really good.
Yeah,
even though they don't have the double squad upgrade, and if they did, they'd be terrifying.
Yeah,
and
I'm glad they don't have it.
And I think Mandos, just with the way the format it has gone, but even the Rebel Mandos I've given more looks at, and I think obviously the Shadow Collective Mandos are better than the Rebel ones. I think Shadow Collective is here. It's just different, and it's going to be represented, I think, like any other Battle Force. I think people, you need to stop. It's not going to be a 5-way split of factions.
No.
I think there's probably about as many Shadow Collectives as there were Bright Trees or Echo Base or Tempest or...
Yeah.
So, Ryan, I've got to ask, what are you worried about your ATRT? Is it just the white save? Is the white save armor 2?
It's the armor 2.
Yeah, from full armor to armor 2.
And they were like, they were dying. They weren't viable. Even though they didn't surge, they weren't viable with full armor. So.
It's having played Spiders, because they're armor 3, but very much the same build. Like, I think it is actually 6-4, surge hit, surge crit. We use a surge crit, and surge block.
An extra armor is an extra freebie block every round. And you can get, you have way easier tech to get,
if not required,
to get dodges on them. Yeah.
So I guess, does the Rebel RT does that now?
Yes, it does. It does.
I mean, at least it's so I don't know. Paper,
Maybe I just need a plan, but I look at, like, what some of these, like, Will's 16 dice, one good shot from his clone infantry can just one-shot my ATRT on a bad ball.
You one-shotted my spider droid.
No, I didn't. I didn't.
It was a Biston one-shot. It was. I fired once with that bad boy, and then he died. You returned fire with Biston.
I think it took 2 shots, though. I think it took 2 shots, because I had some double ion boys down there, too.
Last first, double-shot it, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe it lost first, but it felt like it was a one-shot.
But I had a great time. Joe ran a great event. I was liquored up, which I always enjoy.
Yeah, Joe, make sure that happens for sure.
Home, so
I'll let you serve by the time you drive home. You're fine.
I was sad that I missed the beer garden afterwards. They had a good time, posted pictures, including the new 5280 championship belt that
hell yeah.
Was on the line. I saw this whenever you play. It's nice.
Yeah. No, it's a metal like wrestling belt. Like it's true. Legit. And it changed hands twice during the event, and the new holder of it, Gus, has to bring it to every major tournament, like store championship nice. Or bigger that he goes to now. So
yep, time to retire, boys.
So,
no, that's awesome.
It was super fun. That community is always a great time. And then there is a tournament in between here in Denver towards the end of September that I'm hoping to make so I can keep going with the Legion games. But don't worry, I also played Age of Sigmar. I went to an Age of Sigmar tournament, and I actually went 1-1-1 because you can tie very easily in that game.
That sounds stupid, and I hate this, it.
I hate it, yeah.
I mean, we tied at 33 points apiece after 5 rounds, so it just kind of happened.
So, Tim, did you play a game? No, that's right, Tim's not here tonight. That's
yeah,
right.
No, fuck that guy.
Tim's note to us about his tournament play, it was something... I'm not saying we mocked him.
No, we mocked him.
We mocked him pretty hard. Yeah. He had some takes which were not even hot. They're, lukewarm at best, room temperature. Tim's vision on how this game is played. Yeah.
Are we reading his summary notes
that he wants us to read? We'll read his last will and testament.
New Legion fun, everyone go to Crucible. Wow.
Gosh,
such insight.
That's probably more notes than he normally puts into our show note document.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
So. Right.
Absolutely it is.
Yeah, he's trying to live up to his new Mr. Positive moniker, right? I'm sure there's much more darkness in his heart.
When did he become Mr. Positive? I'm lost.
He said last show that he's always positive, and we laughed at him.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, I'm continuing to mock him.
As we should.
That's fair. I got to play a game Wednesday night, but the more important Legion thing that I got to do is I got to run my first tournament of Legion 2.6. We had a Saturday event at Sci-Fi that Ben abandoned us for. We had 17 players come out, which I was pretty excited for that. And the neat thing was, while it wasn't all like local folks, it was like 3 or 4 from Chattanooga, 3 or 4 from Nashville. A couple guys from Northeast Tennessee, a father son, but it was like a lot of Knoxville folks. The North Carolina guys didn't have to come pad our numbers. The Kentucky guys didn't come pad our numbers. So it was actually a really cool local event, which was pretty awesome.
But that also means you really did have a Tennessee Volunteer Legion. Like you had, Northeast, East, and Middle Tennessee.
Yeah, of course, it was pretty cool.
Memphis, West Tennessee, y'all do your own stuff.
Maybe. Yeah, if you're out there in Memphis, let us know because we don't know you.
I don't think there's any signs of life out there.
Yeah. So we played 3 rounds at the end of it through some pair-up, pair-down situations. We had 3 undefeated players. Actually, it wasn't because of the pair-downs. I needed some pair-downs to do something. Then because of a bye. So we did have 3 undefeateds. Our boy Mitch taking it home. I feel like he's been on the cusp, done really well at a couple of the big tournaments, and it's about time he got his flowers. So I was happy to see him take the thing.
I will say his strength of schedule, because it was a 3-way tie for first. His strength of schedule was a 2, so he had one of the highest ones up there.
He had tough,
but also his victory points scored is tied for first amongst all those lists there. So he's
no, I don't think it's tied for first. I think it is first. Is first and the other two are tied at 30. I think 34.
34. Yeah, they're right.
And he's 35. Yeah. So good on him.
Yeah.
Sam, one of our other locals who gets to make it out, probably more than Mitch at this point, who's always made deep runs. He's missed. I think this is his second tournament in a row at Sci-Fi that he's gone undefeated but missed on strength of schedule or been at the final table of. So great to see him showing out. And then another Ryan who was playing Rebels, who I had not, I don't believe, met before, came up and also went undefeated. So we only had 2 Rebels enter the tournament. Our faction breakdown was not particularly diverse. It was 8 Empire, 6 Republic, 2 Separatists, 2 Rebels, and the 2 Rebels went undefeated, which was pretty cool. I did not think that was going to happen, especially with Mitch, who won the thing, pulled a Fowler and completely rebuilt his list the day before the tournament.
Oh, nice.
Played a game with Nathan, who Nathan just
that's how you do
bodied
it.
Him. And he's like, well, I'm not playing this. so he brought a ton of Fleet Troopers and
I just like brought, the list.
Bought volume of dice. Yeah, it's a very Mitch list.
it's very up close and personal. Like, there's not a yep. ton of long range. I mean, if you're going to do a thing, you're doing it range too. But with the way deployments work now, that works.
Yep.
I mean,
it's Han, it's Mandos, it's Fleet Troopers. It's all in Longshanks if you guys want to go check it out. It was a super fun tournament, but a couple of my takeaways as a TO. I made sure to tell all my players, because this is obviously our first 2-6 event, to play fast and to call me if you need me, and not to get lost in trying to do all the new stuff picturesque perfect. And we had 3 games at a 17-player event that went 3 rounds, 3 total games that needed overtime. Of the same, we did the same 2.5 hour clock, nice. And I didn't have to dice anybody down. Like, all the games finished.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Is that a function of going to the points required, the 12, or is it a function of just better play? Or
I think I maybe 15-20% of the games like ended in turn 4 because somebody hit 12 points. I think it was just, you know, turn 0 takes so much less time. Deployments baked into 1. You've got 1 less round. Stuff yeah. starts dying faster. And I was very intentional with the players. And I gave them about 10 minutes each round to get to their tables and set up. But I didn't like dilly-dally a lot. Everybody just played with intention. You know, we didn't have any invites or anything on the line. We had the store right. championship kit, which was cool. Everybody kind of understood the assignment that we're here to learn Legion 2-6 and get our games on. So, and there was, I think the most repped commander was probably Palpatine, who can also make for some shortened games as you kill yourself and kill your opponent. I think there were 4 Palpatines out of the 8 Imperialists.
And Noxville does love, I mean, they love an Empire. They do.
They do. They do. So it was not a ton of weird rules interactions. Only a couple things I really had to like scratch my head and look up. But everybody played super fast. I could honestly see next year, if not much changes, I could see us going down to 2 hours for tournament rounds.
Ooh.
I really could. And then maybe keeping the 15 minutes of overtime. But really, like, I would love to get to a format where 4 games in a day is more feasible without having to, like, crush players to do it. So... But yeah, it was a great tournament. Players made it easy. Players made it fun. Big shout out to Chris Oglesby for bringing a bunch of Tennessee Volunteer Legion POI tokens. We got to give a bunch of those out. We have Tennessee Volunteer Legion order tokens now, which is pretty sweet for the Tennessee group. Yeah, lots of people brought tons of stuff to give away. It was a fun day. Everybody walked away with stuff. Huge shout out to Sci-Fi City and Walt for putting up with their nonsense, opening the store early for us. So. Good time was had.
I was going to ask that question of you, but since I wasn't going, I wasn't going to do it. You know, I was putting terrain in your car. How'd you get Walt open early?
I told him, do you want to make money?
All right. No, wrong. It does sell Walt pretty yeah. well. It does, actually. Walt's pretty much, yes, he is.
I think all the Nashville guys also walked out with tons of board games, so he'll know awesome. I'll bring the customers in. So.
This is true.
I'm
telling you, if he had cut you and me a commission check and fired Walt, yeah. we would have been
fine. We would, yeah, absolutely. We would
have sold that store out. It'd be empty the next day.
I'm not enjoying this line of thinking, even though I don't even
So it was a great tournament. I'm excited. We're going to try to do another one in between Thanksgiving and Christmas. So if you guys want to put that on your calendars, come on down. It'll be a good time. But I did get to play a game. I played a game Wednesday against Nathan, and Nathan was playing. It was terrifying. Yoda, Chewbacca, Wookiee Battle Force, triple Fluttercraft. So it was a lot of fur. It was 3 bowcaster flutters. I think a naked melee Wook, 2 battle shield melee Wooks, 2 bowcaster shooty Wooks, and then Chewbacca and Yoda.
Yep.
So. It was pretty gnarly, and I've been out on a raft here trying to experiment and see what I really like in Rebels. And I wanted to try to make family reunion work because I think it has a place now with the new deployment rules. Maybe as a turn 1 card to get Sabine and Ahsoka, like, up onto the table quick and to where you can really start harassing and enforcing an issue with two great playmakers turn two. So I brought Cassian, K2, Sabine. Sabine with all of her kit, the shield and the grapple line. Ahsoka with Jedi mind trick reflexes into the fray and sees to what has become, and I don't know that it's the right call, but it's just kind of become my comfort pick of two rebels with ions and then medics if I'm playing like high priority red save heroes, and then a fat fleet trooper with a scatter. And then I round it out with some special forces of Ewok slingers, Clan Ren, and some Pathfinders, because Biston is so good. Biston is so good now.
All right, so looking at historical talk about Biston, one, you and I were there long before that. I was there first, you were there second, but you at least you got there. But second, did we not say if we just take away that refresh piece, he would be fantastic?
Yeah, oh, for sure.
Like, it's not a ton of changes. It's a small change there.
Yeah,
but it makes all the difference.
Yeah, we didn't expect that. Yeah, and give him critical one, which, you know, at the end of the day isn't the biggest of deals. It does help, though. So, the reason I took the combat shield and the grapple line on Sabine is my command card choices were I only brought Cassian, A, to get a token battery, and K2 to try to spool either Sabine or Ahsoka up. And also, Clan Ren does not hate all the aims and dodges. But I wanted to have, I took Symbol of Rebellion and A New Beginning. So Volunteer Mission is a refresh. And then each of my operatives has a refresh card built in as well. So I'm getting lots of uses of hopefully the shield and the grapple line and getting, you know, the force powers back on Ahsoka at least twice. And it worked reasonably well. Plus, I think Sabine or Ahsoka with the suppression for danger sense for the approach turn is pretty funny. It did not go so great for me. Me and Nathan played Breakthrough. I underestimated what those flutters could do and what their threat range to get their back end around to me was. And he pretty much abandoned one of his deployment zones. I did a pretty even split, but he had a Fluttercraft come and last first my Ewok skirmishers, so which were my big threat to kind of go just sit on his back point. I managed to get all the flutters, but Chewbacca was invincible. Chewbacca was invincible to the point to where I had to shoot him 9 times. He took an average of 1 wound per salvo.
Good.
That's gross.
Between Luminous, Barrier, and always rolling just enough surges that he had surge tokens and some lucky saves.
Right.
Like, Biston was throwing, like, you know, 6, 7, 8 dice into Chewbacca, and he would make a couple cover saves and then spend all his defensive tech and then roll 3 paint, and you're just like, what is going on? But
this is also true to the films. I mean, Chewbacca somehow managed to not be on an entire ship that blew up in space.
He kept using Yoda's force push to keep Sabine tied up. But because I wasn't able to be hypermobile with Sabine and like hit his other breakthrough point, I just kept using the refresh cards and getting Sabine's electro grapple line back. So Chewie was stuck on an island between the two breakthrough zones, unable to move for 3 turns, which was pretty entertaining. He just outbodied me. His flutters did just enough damage. Chewbacca's big saves kind of let him in. And some poor token pulls on my part meant he got... we had like this kind of funny Mexican standoff between Battle Shield Wookiees and my fat fleets to see who was going to get like the first punch, and then the next round who was going to get the first punch. And it was pretty gnarly. It was a knockdown dragout game, but Chewie just making a few too many saves and not stranding Yoda on the 2-pip Chewbacca turn was pretty rough. Chewbacca rolled more saves that game than Yoda did. I shot Yoda only once, and he rolled 2 blanks, take 2 wounds. Yoda rolled 0%, but at that point, Yoda wasn't the thing like I needed to kill. I needed to get all the rest of his bodies off the board to be able to push the breakthrough zones. But Nathan played well. It was a good game. Every time I play his Wookiee Battle Force, he just hot dices me off the table, and this one was very little exception. He didn't make any mistakes to like let me back in, and I just did not respect the Flutters with how mobile they are. And now that they can score points, using them especially on breakthrough to stop me from scoring, because he just has to have one guy contesting my point, I had to spend like the first three turns just shooting Fluttercrafts out of the sky. But it was a good game. It was a real good game. I had a lot of fun with it. I'm going to give the list hopefully two more spins before I have to make my decision on what I'm taking to Crucible, but this may make it, because I think it's got some neat tech to it.
It's got some legs. He knows how to use them.
Sometimes.
Well, if you have not checked out the Instagram, you absolutely should, because Will and Ryan were posting there.
It was weird.
And it was kind of weird. And my phone kept going brr, brr, brr. I was like, who is posting out here?
I remember why I didn't post there, because I've gotten so many notifications. I'm like, I hate this.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, also yes, but... Other than that...
Be sure to also check us out
on Instagram.
You should also check us out on Facebook or Truth Social. What the hell?
We've put that joke in there. We've just never taken it out.
It's still there.
We are not on Truth Social.
Threads,
Tim may things. Have a Truth Social account.
I'm pretty sure he does.
Under a pseudonym. Yeah.
I don't know about that.
Probably not. Sure. You're right.
No, Tim does. Tim, it'd be a pseudonym.
Or, you know, on your listening platform of choice, however you deliver our lovely... structured, refined content right into those ears. We appreciate you listening. Give us a rating if you can, or a like, or a whatever the algorithm demands this week at STABcast.
Listen, you know, and we're podcasts survive because we've been so flexible and mobile, both with our morals and with our content. So,
yeah, we are on the Legion Discord, and if you ever want to communally summon us, I think there's a Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade roll now that you can just tag.
Did he just call it STAB?
I think it is Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade.
It's the Sunsphere Tactile Asinine Brigands.
Oh, okay, that's what it is.
I mean,
that's fair.
What, that was an alternate group title that weird word.
That was, it was.
I'll give him that.
So you can summon us there. It'd be awesome.
Yeah.
You can, if you want to support our asinine brigandry, you can go to teespring.com/store/stabcast. Buy a hoodie. It's going to maybe eventually get cold. It's not here in Tennessee yet. Buy some shirts. Buy some fanny packs.
It's a nice 82 today in Colorado.
We got to under 80, and everyone was like, I need to go get my jacket on. And I was like, guys, it's not summer's not over. And then it was like 95 degrees.
Next one is coming. We had our first false fall.
Yeah.
Yes.
We'll usually go through about 12. Three of them.
Which will be, followed up by second false fall, which will also be followed up by thirdsies. So.
Meanwhile, it might snow next month. We'll find out.
If you want to drop us a line about maybe give Ben here some list feedback, you can drop a line at swstabcast@gmail.com.
Oh, speaking of those letters, we did have a nice little letter, and I really liked it. Dinesh Gillen sent us, because he loves a good clone to Linda Est, so we had patches made of it, and I really like it.
We're going to need some.
It's rectangular, it's very clear, you can see from a distance. Yeah. I really like this, so I'm going to see if I can't find out where he had them, or if he has them made, or if he got a shop, something like that.
I was about to say, just have him ship us some, and we'll send him a fanny pack.
Listen, I'll absolutely put that on all sorts of gear, boxes, and bags.
We will absolutely spend Ben's money on things.
Yeah.
Listen, what's the use of working as hard as I do if I'm not willing to spend the money on games I'm not playing, all right?
That's right.
If you like making things out of the bullshit we say, please do, and send proofs of them to us, and we'll see what happens.
In my defense, I bought no games this year at Gen Con.
I know.
I bought a lot of games this year at Gen Con. I did.
Before the listener says, but Ben, you didn't go to Gen Con. You're right, I didn't. But
if we get a nice patch that just says never listen to Tim with a little
I'm pretty sure I could have sent a photo of a random shelf at Gen Con to Ben, and he would have been like, could you pick that up for me?
Brett tried real hard with some Wingspan. Things he tried real hard, and
he
I didn't do it, but I thought real hard about it.
Did not I may have saved metal food tokens.
No one needs metal food tokens, but do they're we there. Want metal food tokens,
but they look so
actually
nice.
Like the point scoring. The point scoring was really nice, too.
Yeah, the point board, yeah.
Yeah.
But if you want to wear your swag and hang out with us, you can come down. I think the next place we're going to be is Crucible. Me, Ben, and Tim will all be there the 6th through the 8th. Hanging out in Orlando, Florida.
I'll be watching the stream.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of how our episodes are going to line up. Are we going to delay our next episode by a week to do Crucible, or is it going to fall appropriately?
Right now, we would record right after you guys get back.
Yes.
Okay.
I've actually taken that day off, the return flight on Monday, so theoretically we should.
I'm not like a moron, but that's okay.
Because the last couple times I've had to leave on Sunday earlier than I wanted.
Sure.
Coming back from Dallas was the thing I wanted to stay that extra day. I kind of wish I had done it.
So, yeah, we won't have a delay in shows. And then you can go up to the Michigan GT. Sadly, I don't think any of us are going to make it. September 21st, 22nd to Lansing, Michigan. You can go to MichiganGT.com for more info. Gurgly, who puts on that show, is one of my favorite people. He's awesome. Go play in his events.
Yeah, I've talked about this. An event I want to go to.
Mm-hmm.
One day.
If you want to go play in a swanky place, you can go to the Grand Geneva Resort in Wisconsin for Dragonfall Hangout with one of our other favorite friends, Kevin Oakes, of Twilight Imperium stream fame on October 5th and 6th.
Anymore. I'm not sure.
That's true. That is true.
But that's all right. I won't show my face at his lovely event.
It's a really nice event. Yeah, like, I really
it's a really beautiful hotel. It's a charity event they put on. Tickets, I think, are still available. Go grab those up. If they can sell enough tickets fast enough, they're going to try to expand the event. It's, I think, 32 players right now, but they want to go bigger. So Dragonfall, October 5th and 6th. Tickets at dragon-fall.com.
Then there's the 3-Foot Good Fall Brawl, October 12th in Davenport, Iowa. A place I'm told has a good amount of corn. So everyone go there, have some corn, play Legion.
Yep.
A healthy amount of corn.
The corn may or may not be husked. You never know.
You never know. It just keeps you guessing.
Yeah.
The Chattanooga Comic-Con is going to be October 26th and 27th. I really liked what they put on last year. Like, I saw the pictures of it, did not attend myself. I really liked what they were up to. I was trying to gather data for dissertation stuff, so that's why I did not go last year. But, I like it. So if you can make it out to that one, you absolutely should.
Captain always does a good job. The venue's great. If you want to go play with Tim for, free wins, at Millennium Games is having their GT November 2nd and 3rd. Go pillage him
for coins.
Go pillage him for coins. Now that we've moved everything to Longshanks, we have those rating points to farm. Go get your free points from Tim.
You can hear him complain about Longshanks.
Sadly, I don't know that any of...
not made by his Lord and Savior.
That's right. And then lastly, kind of rounding out the year is PAX Unplugged in Philly, December 6th through 8th. Right now, it's not in the cards for me. There's a small glimmer of hope that might change. We'll see. I did have a lot of fun last year. I feel like I kind of need to go to try to defend my runner-up's title status. We'll see if we can make it happen. I don't. Right now, it's not looking good, though. But PAX is always a good time. Once you get in the building, getting into the building is kind of a bear.
Right.
But once you're there,
Philadelphia, it's great. Existing.
Well, imagine Gen Con, but you have to put everybody in their bags through a metal detector just to get in. So, the building or the line, wraps around the building, three times to get in the morning. It's sounds obnoxious.
Yeah.
I get that it's for safety, and I appreciate it. But when the tournaments, the doors are open at, 8:30 and the tournament starts at 9, you're just I need you people to move.
Yeah. How many of us are going to LVO? In that January.
I'll be there. Lord willing, the creek don't rise.
Right. I do not have a ticket. I imagine Ben does not.
I mean, I don't have a ticket, but that's never stopped me before.
Fair enough.
No, I'll be, if nothing else, I'll be judging and running doubles. So I'll be there, regardless.
Nice. I'm sure Tim will go. It's one of his favorites always.
Sure. You don't have much of an excuse, Will, I'll be real honest, because my layover is always in Denver.
I know.
So.
Oh, they yelled at me. They're like, we rent a van and drive now.
Yeah.
Wow.
Tickets will come available if you're able to square it away with work. Tickets are, the event is sold out now, but tickets always become available.
I'll be watching. That might be something I should be able to swing it with work. It's just whether I can get a ticket and
the finances,
get a seat in the van, I suppose. Just throw me in the back of the van. That's fine.
Yeah, that's fine.
Just like Nathan, jump in the van with the strange men.
Yes, that is a text message I sent to Nathan. I'm like, here's these friendly lads. Go get in the van.
Time they're like, how's Nathan doing? And I'm like, guys, I live here now. I don't know. I think he's good. They're like, oh, right.
Listen, it's planes, trains, and automobiles. I mean,
yeah.
I did lose Nathan for 2.5 days to the 5280 guys. So.
That's between him and his wife, sir. That's not your business.
They just say little snippets of all the things that happened. They're like, I was never more worried that someone might die. And I'm like, what did you guys do to him? And they're like, oh, you know, I had fun. Like, okay. Took him to drunk karaoke, apparently. I don't know.
Listen, that was one of the greatest weekends of Nathan's life. Which is called what it is.
Sure.
It's called what it is.
True.
I mean.
They still miss
him. So, Will, we're talking about all these things we miss. We're reminiscing. Is there any news? Is there any new news? New things
the
we're
news?
The news.
There's no news.
There's no news.
We should expect that. Minnesota Gonzalez must be close.
Yeah, I think we're probably going to be in a news drought till at least middle of October when the sleeper cell and riot troopers come out. I think it'll be quiet until then, and then probably still pretty quiet till January.
Yeah,
I think so.
But who knows? We might be surprised. I don't think we will be, but I might be surprised.
But there's still a lot to discover in New Legion.
Yeah, it kind of feels like everything's a new release right now.
Yeah.
So much so that we talked about bringing back an old thing that we used to do. Something you haven't heard since episode 53.
Almost 100
episodes ago. Which is nearly 100 episodes ago.
Which is weird to think about.
It is actually more than 100 episodes. We got a couple special episodes in here that bump that count up. I think we're officially like 165 episodes, 163.
Jeez.
So it really was nearly 100 episodes. I mean, it's a lot. But I think we got to talk about how we play with objectives. I think we've got to talk about, you know, it's Red so Player's Dilemma. Now.
The Red Player's Dilemma.
But it's Blue Player's kind of dilemma now, guys.
Blue Player's Dilemma.
So, very quickly, let's review the history of Red Player's Dilemma.
Yeah.
I refused to use any points for bids. In the early days, I was like, you know what? I don't care about a bid. I'll play any comers. Because there were only four objectives. I was like, I'm just always going to build a list. We're going to make a utility. Make sure I can handle all the pieces there. And then we would throw things at me and we'd figure out how I deploy, how we do that part.
Right.
And so tonight we talked about doing that, but we were like, oh, but there's so much that goes into turn zero now. It is a different game. Like, I'm kind of glad we got rid of turn six and put turn zero here.
It's almost like less goes into turn zero.
Yeah.
But so much more goes into turn one.
Yes. maybe that's a better way of saying that. Yes.
Yeah. Like, we could talk about how to approach a game with a certain battle card setup, but I feel like so much is qualified both on what you're choosing to bring, what your opponent's choosing to bring, what the table kind of looks like, now that you don't really know what's in your opponent's battle deck, you can try to, like, guess for what's going to come out of their deck if, you know, you have a really good card for them. But, like, turn zero feels like it matters so much less, and turn one matters so much more with how you deploy things, unless you're playing, like, a ton of prepared positions.
So, yeah, Ryan, let's talk about a thing you have been very concerned about, is how your list matches up against either red saves or armies that bring real heavy big old dice. And so right now, clones are super successful. And right now, beef twos are real good.
They are things that I really don't know how to deal with, because if they close on me, like, my defense can't stand up to their offense. And the normal tricks that I would use of, like, sharpshooter and pierce, like, I can't. If I hit your B2 squad with a full boat from a full sniper squad that's, like, a almost 90-point unit now, like, I deal at most 2.5 B2s.
Oh, yeah, if you're lucky.
That's like, if everything is perfect, I'm probably getting out. That's like, I'm probably getting 2 to 3 wounds through. And that just feels like a really bad trade.
It does. That's because there's so many of them.
I mean, I played against regular B2s, and I was like, man, how do I deal with this health? And then doubling it, like, I don't want to.
I have seen some lists anymore. On some of these long shanks that are 4 beef 2s. I mean, they are.
We had a player play a 6. His name is Drew. He played 6 activations, Grievous, and 5 double stuffed beef 2s.
Oh my god!
And he went 4-1. Like he was, yeah. He was in the ring. He just ran people over. Like he charged towards them and killed them before they could score enough points to win.
There's not much you can do about it. And I'm like, with the new Ion rules, Ion kind of slows them down, but not really. Like I can't deny the whole turn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like they don't have, I've got to ask the question. They don't have free actions like charge or steady, but they're just so much health and so efficient
and red
when
saves
they close.
Now. Yeah.
Red save 2 health, bravery 2, like
me and Ben were talking on average, you have to put like if the dice are even, negating pierce or defensive surge or dodges they might find, you have to put 32 hits into them.
Yeah, if they're going to roll exactly 50-50, it's 16 health. That's before health bots or anything else.
That's insane.
Yeah, no
big
deal.
Before Pogel's card says, you know, we make robots. Mm-hmm. I mean,
And then the other thing I'm having trouble with is just the sheer speed of Anakin. Of being able to come across my table and cut through whatever I've got going on as probably one of the most apex melee predators in the game.
He is a disruptor.
So I have to ask the question then. So Ryan, what kind of objectives, battle plans are you looking for to trying to flip? How can you help negate that with this?
Sure. I don't know. I think I'm looking.
We're all learning right
just
now. Is the other kicker
for the way I like to play? I'm almost more concerned with secondaries because I think secondaries are where you can really get like everybody. I think is mostly going to be reasonably good at all of the objectives together because vehicles score all of them now, droids score all of them now. You know, there's no qualifiers. Recover the research is probably the one of the outliers, and bunker assault just because it has special rules for special forces and operatives and commanders.
Right,
I agree.
But I feel like everybody can kind of play everything, so I think you're really trying to get your edge with controlling secondaries. And, you know, this is the red player's dilemma, but, like, the red player can control those a whole lot better. Or at least whoever's the initial red player.
Right, yeah. Whoever loses the roll-off, effectively.
Mm-hmm.
So do we title this blue player's dilemma?
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, if we want to tie it to the previous segment, yes.
The most common question I got when I was TOing on Saturday was, if I win the roll-off, do I have to be blue? And I was like, yes, it's a complicated coin flip, but the result like doesn't matter. It's not like you win the roll, so you get to choose.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Just whoever rolls more crits is blue. But I think I'm looking at secondaries.
That you want? What's the secondary objective that you want then? For your list, rebel list, hero hammer as best you can. You got some special forces in there trying to roll into red. What secondary objective helps you the most?
So I love destroy the enemy base.
Okay, I do. I like it.
But I think I have to maybe take it out.
And you can score that thing like a guaranteed, basically. Unless you set your whole army around that base token so he can't just control it himself.
Like we just said, where I have trouble just getting a high volume of hits, even if it's not Anakin, just putting it on a 32 save B2 unit. Like, I can just shoot them and shoot them and shoot them, and they'll just wander towards it.
Walk towards you.
So I really think I'm looking for surface scan. I think the more I sit here and think about it, I need surface scan because I think I want to force the game as wide as possible.
I agree.
And I think surface scan does that.
All right.
I think a lot of these lists that I've seen focus on like picking a flank and punching through it.
Right.
And trying to control like the middle and one side. And the more you can spread the game, I think the more those lists are at a disadvantage to some degree.
And so surface scan doesn't like spread it super far, but of the secondaries, I think it spreads them.
Yeah, I mean,
the most.
It's surface scan, and then recon is different, but...
But recon, you're fine to just run into them as long as you're not going to die.
Right. Scan, you have to be...
So as a guy that's only got three-ish games to my name, Surface Scan scares me because that entire first paragraph is a single sentence.
Come on, you're the English major.
Yes. It is, and I read with commas, but starting in the second round, comma, okay, yep. Boilerplate, during each end phase, comma, if a player controls two units that are each holding a scanner, comma, are beyond friendly territory, comma, and are not contesting a POI that is within friendly territory, comma, they score one victory point.
Is that a comma splice, right. Ben?
It's not, but there's a ton of qualifying phrases before I get to score one victory point. I have to have two units. They have to be beyond friendly territory. Can't be contesting a POI that is within friendly territory. So they've got to be not basically engaging in your other objective for points.
It sound like reading that makes it sound much more complicated than it is on the table. Like you just have to be.
One of your units isn't babysitting your home point.
Yeah. Both of your scanner units really have to be out beyond your deployment zones.
But so this is really the scene from Spaceballs. It's two troopers walking around with a giant comb saying we ain't found shit. Like that's
what this is. But they did find shit. They find victory points.
They find a victory
point. They find them.
But they better not drop the comb, otherwise it's worth 2 points to your enemy.
And I also think it's really good for Rebels, although the lists I'm contemplating playing aren't super high in activation count. I think it's also really good if you're for being able to punch last and maybe get them to drop a scanner on the last act of a round before, because it's remarkably easy to pick the scanner back up if it's your enemy, your own scanner.
But can so I being just able suppress to, them down?
I mean, you only drop things after you rally, so I don't think so. I would have to look at the new panic rules if those units are probably still ignored on victory cards, if how that language is used. That's a good question. You might be able to just panic them down, which is easier to do nowadays.
That's true, since you score before removing.
Right.
Which I think is a good change, actually.
That's a great change.
It makes it much more impactful than it used to.
Yes.
But
But yeah, that's probably what I'm looking for. I'm definitely not looking for bring them to heal.
No.
I'm definitely not looking at marked targets because I'm probably just going to lose guys the attrition war faster. I'm probably only looking at marked targets if I'm playing Din or IG and I'm trying to like get a double incentivize myself to go for bounty.
Right.
Sweep and clear is okay. I tend to play a little aggressive, so like getting that two victory points in enemy territories probably a little bit easier for the way I like to play. But also it's also easy for other people to do. But it's once again a fighty card, so that might be just as easy for my opponent to score.
Hmm.
So
I see that when you and I played Destroy Enemy Base, I mean Din was right in the It took it to the very end only because I sacrificed a whole bunch of units and points.
Yeah, from it. I could have scored it at any point I really wanted to.
Right.
I just had to try to score your other breakthrough point or stop you from scoring breakthrough as long as I could and then go and score the enemy base.
Mine did require my punching army of B2s to get in close.
Which you were going to do anyway. and maybe I still take Destroy Enemy Base because I think it's... You're going to have to get really creative where you put your base. Like, I think my first inclination is to put it where you want to go kind of anyway. But maybe trying to lure them into maybe an easier to score spot, but a more irrelevant spot might be the way to go.
For the other objective pieces? Yeah. I can see that.
So it's try to lure something away. I don't know. It's going to take some calls, but I do think I'm focusing on my secondaries. I don't know how you guys have been building battle decks. My objectives and secondaries shift deck to deck. My advantages are, I think, pretty much always the same three.
I was going to ask that question because I think mine are probably always going to be the same three.
I think everyone has their favorites, really.
And why is it advanced intel?
Yes.
It isn't for me.
It is. That's crazy.
Nope, it isn't for me.
No, it's... Ben, that pass token is so good on the first turn.
It's so good on the first turn.
The longer you can delay deploying, like, the less info you're giving your opponent. Like, it's so good.
But remember, I'm a droid man, so I always love a good fortify position.
Cover doesn't do what it used to.
It doesn't, but it helps me, because I wasn't getting a ton of cover from suppression tokens beforehand. So,
I mean, I guess the heavy cover roll is better than your save, so it's...
Yeah.
It feels all right. It's like I mean, for me, it's advanced intel, cunning, and garrison.
Oh, see? For me, I'm never going to touch those things, I feel.
Like, oh, garrison's so good.
I like strafing run.
Strafing run and ordnance are trash. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I think, because I also like bring them to heal, though. And so bring them to heal is what got me in my game, I think, against you, Will.
Yes. And strafing run. It didn't decide the game, but it got you an extra point on bringing them to heal, yeah.
Yeah. It got me much, much closer.
I also just never want to play bring them to heal. I don't think it's very fun. I much prefer sweep and clear.
The only time I want to play bring them to heal is if I'm playing against an armor skew list.
Okay.
Because they have less things that require suppression tokens for me to score. To get the extra 2 points for all enemy units.
They can gain suppression tokens,
have one. Like, if they've got a bunch of dark troopers or vehicles or tanks or whatever, and they have, like, five guys that can take suppression, neat, I can do that.
Yeah, that's fair.
Right.
No, I don't like strafing run, because it's so easy to play around. Like, very rarely are you going to get more than one unit if your opponent is, you know, clever and sees it coming, because you have to do it at the start. Ordnance I can take from time to time if I'm not taking a bunch of other impacts, since it just deals straight wounds and it's not like wounds against a save.
Right.
That's pretty great.
I do.
But like cunning deployment, while I'm supposed to love it as a rebel player for dodges.
Yeah.
And I do have it in my family reunion deck. It's one of those things like your opponent has to let you use it.
Sure.
Where like, oh, okay, you got some dodge tokens, so I guess I just shoot something else.
I see it more as a deterrent to keep your important stuff alive.
No, that's fair.
It's like, I want these squads to survive longer, so I put I disincentivize you shooting them right now, make them tougher.
Yeah,
I have other units that I'm more okay losing health on right now, you know, kind of thing.
Sell me on garrison. It's not that I'm against it. Maybe I don't understand prepared position, because I have not played the games with you guys.
You don't understand prepared positions.
Prepared positions, you deploy like Old Legion. You deploy in the deployment zone, and you get a free dodge token. So you don't have to waste your first action point on the board, and you're further up the board than your first move would have taken you.
And you start with the dodge on top of that.
Yeah, yes. Imagine if your B2 fat squads had a dodge token and butted right up to the edge of your territory.
Which are now 1.5 off the edge, so they're they're 3 extra inches further along, and those 3
they're kind of like an old Legion. That's yes, they do. It's kind of like Old Legion Scout 1 is kind of what it feels like.
Yeah,
gotcha.
With a dodge token, so like infiltrate kind of does the same thing, except you don't have to drop them till you activate, but you don't get the dodge, so it's like less good than infiltrate. But just being able to put it on anything is awesome.
Yeah.
And you can prepare your position and also scout?
No.
Okay. It's one or the other. Okay.
Yeah. Prepared positions, transport, scout, and infiltrate, like, all have the same trigger, like, timing.
They're so
you
exclusive.
Can, if you have access to multiples of them for one reason or another, you get to use one of them.
So,
but no. Prepared positions, just if you've got a fat squad of core that you want to start on the table. It just helps get you there.
Yeah.
And so for me, I take it if I'm taking fully loaded fleets, which I almost always am.
I understand that. So. That I get.
Yeah, I ran it because if it came up, I would deploy one of my phase 2, you know, infantry squads up there.
Clone infantries, yeah.
And then I would give Anakin the scout instead of prepared, but, you know.
Interesting, okay.
Anakin's prepared kind of bit me a little bit, like, you do have to show where he's going to have his board control start from, and your opponent can counter deploy that, where in one of my games, he basically nullified Anakin for the first three rounds because he just said, no, thank you. No Anakin.
I don't believe that. And the only reason I say that is you can do three speed, three moves. So if you can bait him to go with one, you know, overcommit to a flank because you prepared your Anakin over there, as long as Anakin isn't taking, like, shots and you've got him behind a line of sight blocker, then you can just, like, activate him last.
Yeah.
And then one pip him first on turn two and just be in the complete opposite corner of his deployment zone.
I mean, yeah. But I don't want to have to use it on that, you know?
I mean, if you bait his whole army out of position, I'm fine with it.
Fair, like, yeah. No, I just have to get more used to it, but...
Yeah. But Anakin, I think, is the exception, not the rule.
Right. No,
for,
I think...
For that.
When you're talking about prepared, you're talking more about the OT faction core that have it and
other things like dish, that. The dish, the E-Web.
Yeah.
It does have a little bit of a downside, like, for the E-Web and the dish. Your opponent knows where your line of sights are.
Right.
Knows what fire lanes you're taking ownership of. And you can't, like, hide those behind line of sight blockers because their whole utility is being able to see.
Right.
Right. So, but to kind of loop this back to turn zero, advanced intel is just the best. Like... I think it's an automatic veto if you have a veto and your opponent has intel flipped. I think almost above anything else, you get rid of it.
Right. I think it is the most impactful on the first turn.
Yeah, it's one that's guaranteed to hit. There's no downside. It's not like you put a fortified position down. Yeah, you put down fortified positions and the battle just doesn't take place around those barricades. You're not going to forget to use your strafing run token until halfway through turn five. You know, it's not like cunning deployment where the dodges just may fall off. Like, if you have an opportunity to use advanced, you take it.
Yeah.
If your opponent has it, unless you're just screwed by the other two cards or the table edge, you get rid of their advanced intel.
Yep. I am on the same page, Ryan.
So,
well, that's a scary place to be, if you're honest.
I know.
Rarely agree on a thing. I mean, yeah, I was like,
I remember reading through these advantage cards and not being super impressed, but now I'm starting to see how some of them are more impactful than others.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I will say, the two that I've picked here, Strafing Run and Ordnance, are later game pieces where Advanced Intel, Fortified, even Garrison, like I said, those are all start of the game.
So let's talk about Ordnance and Strafing Run. And there are going to be exceptions. Do not get me wrong. There will be exceptions to this. These feel to me like win war cards. I don't think they're powerful enough to really swing you back into a game that you're losing. But if you're either on pace or ahead, they just help you win more. I don't see them being the you know, flipping the script on your opponent, like, aha, I got a strafing run off and now I denied you a victory point on the middle. Like, if you drop the token, your opponent is going to know, like, okay, whatever I throw at this, if he can line up the movement tool to catch any of my cohered guys, I'm just going to lose that point, so I guess I'll just allocate my resources elsewhere this round. Ordnance, oh no, there's an armor thing, I guess I should probably move generally away from this objective token. I don't think they flip the game. I think they just, if you're already ahead or you're tied, they'll help you, but I don't think they help you out of a bad situation. While advanced intel just gives you an extra deployment of information on your opponent.
I wonder if it comes down to just a difference in the objective pieces then. Because in general, I've used those two pieces on places where the objective was, like, they had to sit on this point to score the points to be up. Like, they're more contesting objectives rather than just sit and score objectives.
Right. And because objectives aren't, like, in Warhammer, if you control an objective, you can walk away from it and you still control it.
Sure.
Until someone else takes it from you, essentially. But since you can't do that with POIs, like, you have to stay camping there to hold it every round for most of the objectives.
Right.
For some you don't, like Breakthrough, for example, you know, you have right. to be there. Right, I think
breakthrough's the one, the only one, though.
No, close the pocket and shifting, like, you have to have control of the token every round to score the token.
Right? No, that's what I mean. I think breakthrough's the only one that scores by itself.
Yes. Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, breakthrough's the only one where you score your home ones by having nothing there.
Right.
No enemies there, so you don't have to have a friendly unit there babysitting it, even though you probably want to play defense. But anyway.
Right.
Since you can't do that, I see what Ben's saying about trying to use them as, like, area denial, like, okay, you need to hold this point, but I'm going to detonate this thing over here, and that's going to affect you for this, or especially ordnance versus armor, I think.
Yeah, the, ordnance versus armor. I mean,
the, you could spike those wound rolls pretty hard. I don't know that it's something you should rely on, but it's something to scare your opponent, perhaps.
I mean, yes, you could theoretically roll 3 crits and do 6 wounds to something, which, you know, is an entire ATRT.
Or you hold it for later in the game, and they have a couple of wounds left, and you try to kill it, you know.
Yeah, I don't. But once again, I think I'm not saying they're useless. I guess I'm just saying that I don't see them flipping the script. You're gonna lock down this with strafing on. Okay, I'm just gonna double move these guys over to this other point that you were securing and bully you off of that one instead.
Sure, I'm playing devil's advocate, but I still don't.
I gotcha. Yeah,
I'm not bringing them.
I don't
now.
Think advantages should ever be a thing that's gonna flip the table on a thing. It should give you opportunity. It doesn't mean it's an auto win thing, and I don't know that.
I don't know
Advanced Intel
ones.
Is an auto. Yeah,
it's not an auto not win, but it's an automatic like positive effect
it's,
on
it,
your first.
It's
round.
A net. Yeah, Advanced right. Intel.
It's not
going to
blank out, or your opponent can negate it. Really, like it's happening. It's a guarantee.
Yeah.
Start of the game, first round. Like you're not going to forget it. You're not going to miss it. You know. I mean, you might
cunning deployment
it.
Is 3 free actions that you just get. Are the greatest of actions
now? That
now.
I get. Now that I absolutely Garrison
is an action and a half to 2 free actions. Really right. 3 if you add the dodge token in there. We're really taking it just for the mobility aspect.
2 moves and a dodge for free.
Yeah.
On one core unit.
And it's something that your opponent like can't counterplay. You're just getting that value from that pass token. Of like, okay. And even the value of I have advanced intel, you have advanced intel, I as the blue player reach into my bag, shuffle it around, and then say I pass. And then you pass right back. I still gained value by not letting you have an extra pass after me.
Yeah.
Right.
Because passing when you out-activate your opponent is nuts. Just to be able to say, no, I will not show you what I would like to do. Please deploy something.
Especially if you're on that perfect bubble of you have one more activation than your opponent.
Yeah, when there's normally none. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I've been to places where, in previous Legion, where you could, where you did need that roll-off to happen, and then for some reason it happened every time. I've done that, where I've lost the roll-off that would be more advantageous for me. And so getting that pass token on turn one does allow you to see where everyone else is going. Like, I get that. I do.
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's a bad card at all. I'm not.
It can also depend on philosophy, whether you, Ben wants to put a token down and say, don't stand here or I'll blow you up, I guess.
Yeah. Well, the other and not to play the but my dice card, but these dice. Are dice dependent.
Yeah,
like they are dice dependent. They're both 3 and 4 black dice apiece, so they're pretty reliable.
They get at least
but,
one.
But if Ben makes his master plan to drop that strafing run to body somebody off of a point, and then rolls 4 blanks. And put all of his mental mindset into bullying his opponent with it, and then it just doesn't pay off. Like that is the most feelsy bad of moments. If all the others like just fire off.
I agree.
Yeah.
I mean,
I think strafing run and ordnance look more impactful when you first look at them, but then to me it feels like the other ones are more guaranteed and more.
Oh, helpful. when I first was going through the game, I didn't think advanced intel. I was like, that's all I get as a pass token. Like,
yeah,
that seems kind of lame.
But oh, wait.
And then I realized how good it was in practice.
And I will say, I am not well practiced with pass tokens in general because I've almost always out activated my opponents in previous leagues.
Sure.
I mean, so I do have a lack of experience with passing.
Yeah, and I think that's something I think you're going to play it once. Like, I would encourage you to put it all in every one of your decks, no matter really what you're playing. I don't know that there's a list that is bad at for advanced intel. And start playing around. Like, I think Dark Troopers took a hit, obviously, losing their full armor status. But they got a sneaky buff in the fact that you build your pass pool off of activations and or off of units instead of activations. So Dark Trooper players are going to have, you know, theoretically one more quote unquote pass than for every unit they bring, which is pretty gnarly. So I'm terrified to play a Dark Trooper player who has advanced intel.
Yeah. And even when you add activate, just having that one, like, no, I will not give you more info. Please continue doing what you're doing.
Please continue,
like,
yeah.
Even if it just burns one of their passes. Like.
Or I've played my 3-pip. I've got perfect order control on my core. I know just my high-value targets are in the bag, so I activate core, and then go and burn my pass then before I really need to see where my playmakers need to go.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I was already doing that because I have perfect activation control.
Exactly, but you could pause one more time.
But you could pause one more time, yeah. Ooh. Yeah.
I get off on denying on turn one or denying at the end? Ooh, that's a tough
one. We know you get off on denying all the time.
I just guarantee denial.
Yeah.
It is a, yes.
And you know who I think this card will really benefit? The Gungan Battle Force. They'll surely out-activate everyone, and this pass token could be really effective for them.
All of them, man. That was I was not expecting the end transition there, but here we are.
We're here. Wrapping it up.
We don't want to talk about recover the research and shifting priorities.
Not yet. We can stretch that out. All right.
We'll hold those bad boys. Yeah.
That's fair. All right. Well, Gungans are the secret keyword to shut the show down. So, thanks for spending your drive time, your advanced intel time, your pass token time with us. We certainly do appreciate it. And, you know, I don't know why you listen to the show, but we're grateful. So until next time, I'm Ryan Slawoski reminding you that, you know, we'll find something that's really cool in Rebels eventually. Maybe. I don't know. There's too many options. And why is it always Bad Batch?
What a great message for the people. I'm Will Heim reminding you that I painted more minis in 3 weeks than I painted for Ben in all of 2023.
And I paid him for those. I paid him for those pieces. Poor return on my investment. And I've been Fowler reminding you all that we're still here when all the other ones aren't, because we've been warning you about clones this entire time. Clones Delinda Est, everybody.
Clones B2's Delinda Est.
Don't let them get comfortable. Delinda Est.
Can't get rid of the beef. We're not vegetarians in this podcast.
B2's Delinda Est.
Make them 70 points and we'll be fine. 36 saves. 36 saves.
It's a lot.
Listen, I wouldn't bother me. 6 points? They wouldn't bother me. Yeah. I'll spend 6 points on that. Done. Count me in. Bap.
All right. You heard it here first, boys and girls. Goodbye.
Goodbye, everybody.
What if Spider-Man just sucked toes instead of solving crime?
That'd be... I'd watch that.
Oh, I would not watch that. No.
Would you not? Why not?
It's you and Quentin Tarantino.
That's fair.
Now listen, it was Salma Hayek's toe.
It's true.
Which, all right, you know what? I get it.
I really hope this is recorded.
I'm recording this.
So yeah. I'm recording. Yeah. This would be great. What's the reason you guys have had such great longevity with your podcast? I don't know. We just talk about bullshit and Legion.
Yeah.
We don't.
And Legion. Listen,
we don't pretend to dawn, be. We don't pretend to be anything we're not, I think, is the real answer to that question. But, you
that's
know.
Really it. Listen, if the Stabcast were the crew from Dusk Till Dawn, Tim would definitely have been, you know, the Quentin Tarantino character in that film.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
He thinks he's George Clooney.
He thinks he's George Clooney, yeah.
He is absolutely not.